Welcome to today's session of Applied Mathematical Finance and its object-oriented implementation. And today I like to start a session on interest rates. So we will start defining interest rates, then define some interest rate products, some simple products, which actually can be valued without even using a model. And then to value more complicated products, we will then define interest rate models that allow us to value more advanced products. And let me shortly remind you that we had a small recap where I showed you or I reminded you of the universal pricing theorem. So if you have a model for say some quantities representing objects of your financial market, for example, the prices of financial products, but could also be derived quantities like interest rates, then under certain conditions, you can have this nice theorem that you can value any financial derivative on these objects by just taking the expectation on the under the corresponding equivalent martingale measure. Once you have selected one dedicated financial product, which is your numerea, so it is the reference asset, that describes that you measure all values relative to this asset. Yeah? So you measure the value, for example, of a car in terms of bananas or something like that. And the existence of this probability measure and also the interpretation of the value that you are calculating depends on a few requirements. The existence, for example, that the market has some properties like completeness, or uniqueness, then no arbitrage or whatever. And the interpretation of the value that you are calculating is that you are able to perform replication. And I will not discuss this, so I just assume you either know this or we just assume that we can apply this theorem. So I will not very often recall these assumptions. Yeah, so just assume that we have this structure. Okay, and one example that you already know, maybe from other lectures or that we used in numerical methods very often to illustrate a numerical method, was the Black-Scholes model. And here you see the Black-Scholes model again. So actually it is a model for a single asset stock, but the model uses two assets. There was the stock S, okay, which followed this stochastic process here, and it has some source of uncertainty of randomness modeled by the Brownian motion, the DW. And there was another financial product, which was our savings account, which was just evolving like exponential RT. Yeah. So the solution of this is n of t is n of 0 times e to the rt. So there were already two financial products. And actually, the formulation which I have here already is under the equivalent martingale measure. So this here is already under the measure that uses the numerea n. Yeah. So there is already the qn here. So the numerea was this asset n. So if you go back, it means that you have to use this numerea here. And this guy here is the interest rate earned over an infinitesimal period. Yeah? So this is an interest rate. So interest rates were already there in the background when you had a Black-Scholes model. But the nice thing was that interest rate in this model, the interest rate was just a constant. So it was deterministic. So it was not stochastic. And since you know that n of t is just exponential rt times n zero, this means that you can just move this numerea out of the expectation operator here. Yeah, so you can move this n of capital T in front because it is not a random variable, it's just a deterministic function. So now, if we start looking at interest rates, I will from the beginning consider that everything here is a random variable or a stochastic process, yeah, if we evolve it over time. So we will first look at interest rates and interest rate structures, but the objects we consider are random variables. You maybe understand that this makes the whole world a little bit more complicated because we have a stochastic numerair, yeah, and things become maybe more interesting. So that was a small prologue that actually interest rate modeling should maybe be the starting point of looking at financial models, because usually interest rates are your numerair. And the assumption that your numerair is deterministic is maybe a bit crude. Okay. So I start by maybe defining interest rates first. So models that model the stochastic processes will come up later. So again, what we have done in previous examples was that we considered a one-dimensional stochastic process when looking at Black-Scholes model, a one-dimensional stochastic process. For example, that one modeling a scalar value, you know, the stock price, S of t. And now things become a little bit more interesting also because of another aspect. If you ask, oh, what is the interest rate? Say, we are here. What is the interest rate we earn? So the interest we earn. So if you put money on your savings account from little t to say capital T. Okay, so then the interest earned from there to there, yeah, can be completely different from what you earn from there to there, even if both intervals are just 1 year. Yeah? So it could be that in the second year you earn a different value. Yeah? So that means actually I can have a whole family of interest rates. So whatever we earn from here to there, and so on, yeah, the interest may somehow have a complicated dependence on the final value of capital T, the final time, the maturity. Okay, so you see that actually already starting to think about interest rates will introduce a whole family, a whole curve of objects. Yeah? So this is actually an interest rate curve. And here on this slide, I'm looking at the interest rate from little t to capital T. Yeah, so all have the same starting point, but different endpoint. Okay, so that is another aspect why interest rate modeling is maybe a bit more demanding. Yeah. So if capital F of capital T, semicolon little t, denotes the interest rate we earn over the period from little t to capital T. So what does this mean? So we have a certain period, it starts in little t and in capital T, and then we have here the word rate. So actually I'm not measuring the money that I earn after this period. I measure the money per time. So that means in the definition, if we invest an amount of capital N at time little t, so this is our initial investment, then I assume that what I receive back is the amount N. Okay, so n times one plus something in addition. So f is the scaling factor of this additional amount. So I receive n times f. multiplied with time. So that part here is referring to the rate, and that part here is the interest earned. Yeah. Okay, so this is just the definition of F. Yeah. So I'm defining F as the amount per unit time I receive if I invest from little t to capital T. Okay, so that is the amount that we receive then in capital T in terms of F. So that is now just my definition of the object capital F. So there could be different other ways of defining what you receive back. Yeah? So this is just one way. But you see, I'm measuring this in units per time. Yeah, so units per time. So actually, it is 1 divided by time is the physical unit of this object F. So now for different times, for 2 different times, we can have different Fs, of course. Yeah. So I'm already dividing by the length of time. So you could think that F is maybe a constant, like you receive 5% for every year. Yeah. But actually, it can be that this amount depends on the time, capital T2. So for different times, I can observe different interest rates. So maybe it is more expensive to borrow money in the winter than in the summer or whatever. Yeah. So there could be different reasons. Yeah. Or you know that, for example, there is some kind of crisis. So currently, maybe interest rates are higher, but the people expect that the crisis will go away and then interest rate will go lower. Yeah. So there is already some structure, some time dependency in these interest rates. And remember, compared to what we had here in the beginning, when we were looking at the stock, yeah, the little s of t is the time when we observe this. Yeah, this is today. I observe the stock today. The little s of t is the time when we observe this. This little t is already here, yeah, and it's a different t. I observe today interest rates for different periods. Yeah, if I go to a bank and ask, I would like to borrow money for 1 year, maybe they give me a different value of this F compared to if I asked, I would like to borrow money for 2 years. So now I could decompose this into, say, smaller pieces for a given time discretization. So we can decompose this into say small interest rates periods. Okay, so we decompose this. And then I actually can just define, so note here, I'm just defining here the right hand side. I can just define this interest rate from little t to tk as being the result of borrowing money, yeah, or putting money on the savings account from T0 to T1. And then I get back 1 plus, now I define this object as L, yeah? 1 plus L from T0 to T1 multiplied with the time. So this is what I get back if I invest. Yeah? Okay, and so on. Okay, and observe here that I define these values. So this is a definition and all have the same little t here. Yeah. So this is not what we will later see some strategy. Yeah. It's just a definition of the right-hand side. I just want to define the object on the left-hand side by these small intervals. Yeah? So let's maybe draw a small picture here. Yeah. So this here is the interest rate from little t, which is t0, to say tk. So tk is here. Yeah. So, and one way of expressing this is to say, okay, at the end you receive 1 plus f tk minus little t. But you could also say, okay, let's express this in terms of smaller rates for these time intervals. This is just an alternative representation of this large rate. Okay, so maybe this is here ti to ti plus one. And if you know all the f's for all the different tk's, yeah, for t1, t2, t3, then you can actually solve for the l's. Yeah, because then we get that the L for a certain interval from, say, ti minus 1 to ti can be extracted by, okay, the F is the product over all these 1 plus L. Yeah? So I take the long product to ti and I divide by the long product to ti minus 1 to get 1 plus L. Yeah? So take the product from the beginning up to ti, this is this part, and divide by the product from the beginning to ti minus 1 to get one of these 1 plus l times delta t, yeah, in the middle. Okay, and then just subtract the minus 1, it is 1 plus L, and divide the delta T. Yeah? So we can extract these L's. This means that we can actually represent our interest rates if we only look at these discrete times. Yeah? If we only look at the discrete times T0, T1, T2, and so on, then we can represent the different interest rates we observe by these small intervals. And whenever I would like to know an interest rate from T0 to a certain time, I have to calculate this product. Which means I have decomposed this curve in, say, discrete intervals. It's a kind of discretization that I have performed. And now the argument is that all these guys here can have different values. So maybe there could be different stochastic processes. So you see, in contrast to having for the Black-Scholes model a single S, yeah, DS is blah, 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 sigma or SDW, yeah, that moves around here. Okay, now anyone here can move around up and down. So in this view, you see I have, say T0, T2, 1 is already known, it's deterministic, but T1 to T2, T2 to T3, they can still move. Yeah? So I have a five-dimensional stochastic process. And the dimension is just given now by how fine I discretize time. So you see that interest rates are taking this view a much richer structure. So there are interest rates models that model the continuum of the whole curve. Yeah? But actually, when we implement this in the computer, often, yeah, so even for so-called short rate models, which look as if they model the continuum, often we end up in some discretization. Yeah? So even, for example, if you just have a very fine discretization of every day, yeah, so that will be a discretization. So it's maybe not such a big deal if we assume discretization. But we will also discuss models that model a whole continuum of the curve. So these points here, the points capital TI, they have a name. Yes, this is called a tenor structure. So this tenor structure is somewhat the time discretization for the interest rate curve. So starting, our discussion here with an interest rate, and I will make this precise in a few minutes, with an interest rate that applies for actually little t to ti, so applies for the period from little t to ti, we can extract these interest rates for the small sub periods L from ti minus 1 to ti, yeah, by this nice formula, or obvious formula. And this then defines us, since we view these interest rates as stochastic, a random variable L from ti minus 1 to ti. So we observe this random variable in little t. So all the random variables currently on here on the slides are observed in little t. So this random variable is ft measurable. And these times, they mark the beginning and the end of the interest rate period. So that is just one way of representing this interest rate curve. And it's just the motivation that the world of interest rates and modeling interest rates is just by having these dependencies on time, on the maturity. So just by having this tenor structure is much richer. Yeah? We have immediately a portfolio of stochastic processes. So I will now take a very axiomatic way of defining the interest rate, and we will start by defining an idealized product, the zero Cooper bond. And all the rates, like forward rates, short rates, will then derive from this financial product. And we also have then another, say, financial product, the accrual account, which will then define the backward-looking rate, which is, maybe now more prominent because it is considered as the new reference rate for interest rate derivatives. Maybe I make a small remark on this in a few seconds, but let's start with these definitions. So maybe this is a bit boring, because now what comes now is just a big list of definitions where we have to walk through. Most things are quite easy, but in the end, you will see that all the different interest rates and all the different models are actually nicely linked together and based on a single financial product. So I define here the zero Cooper bond, or I often just say bond. Yeah. So what's that? This is the guaranteed payment of a unit currency 1 at a future time t2. And I trade this product at time little t before t2. And I ask, what is the value to receive 1 unit in capital t2? What is the value of this contract in little t? Yeah. So you can think of this as you receive 1 unit of currency at time t2. And you ask, okay, if I would like to receive this, how much do I have to put into my account at time little t? So that is the amount you have to put into your account there. Or if you like to borrow money and you ask yourself, I would like to pay back 1 unit, how much money do you get in little t? Okay, so this is a zero Cooper bond. So I have a fixed known payment in the future. And I ask, what is the value of this financial product in little t? So I can vary the time when we receive this 1 unit. And of course, the product, so the value p of t2, semicolon little t, so observed in little t, will depend on this t2. Yeah, because receiving it just now, I have that the value is 1. Yeah, so p little t is equal to 1, because receiving 1 now is one. Receiving it later, maybe the value decreases because you have to wait longer for the money. Okay, so I assume that this is a traded product. So this is a product I can observe on the market. And since we think in terms of random variables, I observe it at a certain time and in a certain state. Okay, so there's also the omega. So the value is determined by the little t and the omega. So when do I observe the value and in which state do I observe the value? And I call this now the bond price, yeah, with maturity t2. So this PT2 semicolon T and omega is a real number, a value. So this means PT2 semicolon T is a random variable and PT2 is then a stochastic process. Okay, so I assume that this financial product exists. And maybe one important remark here, I assume that the payment is guaranteed. So this is risk-free. So there is no possibility that this bond defaults. Yeah? So the value of this bond is the amount that I receive in that I have to pay in little t to receive one unit in t2. Yeah? So I have to pay here the amount pt2 observed in little t. We make the assumption that we can trade fractions of these products, and actually fractions in terms of real numbers, yeah? And that the price to buy and sell this product is the same. This is an idealization, so we have a lot of idealization in this section here, yeah? But later we can discuss what happens if we break this up. If I can buy or sell any fraction of this, I can ask that I would like to have a fraction of this, namely just one divided by PT2 little t units. So this is the number of units of this bond. So actually, if we talk about units, at this point, I'm often a bit sloppy and not writing the unit of the financial product. But if you are not sloppy, then the unit here is some currency. So for example, this here is euro. So this here is 1 euro, okay? So the unit of this P is euro, the currency unit. And this means the amount which I have to multiply here in front is actually 1 euro divided by P. Yeah? So if P is measured in terms of euro, 1 euro divided by something which is measured in euro is a scalar number, which is unitless. So it is a fraction. So I'm a bit sloppy about these units, so I don't write it down. But later when we consider interest rates in different currencies, yeah, so we also will look at hybrid models, then this becomes important. And also often looking at the units is sometimes helpful to check if an equation is correct or not. So sometimes I make these remarks. So if I buy 1 divided by PT2 units, this means that if we do that, I pay here 1, okay, and I receive back 1 divided by PT2T. Actually, it's 1 euro multiplied with 1 euro. Yeah, okay. So it is 1 euro squared divided by euro, so it is euro. So if you know the price of this zero coupon bond, which tells you what is the value of receiving €1 at a future point, you could also get the amount if I pay €1 or if I borrow €1 today, what do I get in the future or what do I have to pay back in the future? So I can just operate here with the inverse. Note that this object here is known in time little t. Yeah? So this here is ft measurable. Yeah? Little t is the time when we observe the object. In this section here, everything is little t measurable. It will change at the end of the section. I already made this remark. We have a certain idealization here. The zero coupon bond that we consider is default free. Yeah? So default free is means that the payment is guaranteed to occur. So this is an idealization. Yes, you know, in the market, it's the counterparty, yeah, which trades with you, could go bankrupt. Yeah, and it could happen that it doesn't pay the money back. And if you have this situation, actually, you immediately understand that interest rates are not universal. Yeah, they are not something which apply to everything. Actually, they depend on the counterpart that is offering the trade. Yeah? Alternatively, if you go to a bank and ask for a loan, yeah, you would like to buy something, maybe the bank will give you a different interest rate than if some other guy goes to the bank and asks for this loan. Yeah? So maybe they will check the credit worthiness of the person. So there may be different reasons why interest rate actually depend on the counterparty. And speaking of bonds, it depends on the issuer. Yeah? So what we have here that the bond is guaranteed to pay this is an idealization. So it is a risk-free bond. Yeah? This is an idealization. And what we should do is consider issuer-specific bonds. Say issuer A, so this superscript A here should be the label of the issuer, has a certain issues a bond, and this bond has a certain price. This will ultimately result in that we not only have different interest rate for different times, we have even different interest rate curves, namely as each issuer has a different curve. So the curve that we are currently modeling here is the risk-free curve. And the world in this setup is a bit simpler. So, okay. So let's go back here. We have the zero coupon bond, the guaranteed payment of receiving one unit at a fixed time in the future at capital T2. Yeah? So capital T2 is actually called the maturity. So this guy here is then the maturity. Of this bond. And now I will derive everything from this object. So I assume that this object can be observed on the market. Now, here actually, I told you that this is an object which does not exist and it's an idealization. But even in this idealized sense, or even in a non-idealized sense, it doesn't exist on the market. The market trades different products, swaps, for example, yeah, or coupon bonds or floating rate bonds, yeah. And but anyway, we will later see that all these products can be expressed in terms of this zero coupon bond. Yeah? So somehow this is like an atom, an atomic object, which actually contains all the information of the interest rate curve. Given that we just have a single interest rate curve, and we are in this situation that we do not consider the issuer specific part of the interest rate. So the next object I like to define is the forward bond. So the forward bond given two times, so I have T1 and T2, given two times, I define the forward bond as being the ratio of the zero coupon bond at the later time T2 divided by the zero coupon bond at the earlier time T1. So this is also, remember, P capital T is the price of receiving one unit in capital T. This is a stochastic process observed in little t in state omega. So this P T1 T2 is also a stochastic process. Yeah? So this here is a stochastic process that is defined over the time little t can go up to T1. Because if I reach T1, the zero coupon bond PT1 no longer exists. Yeah? So maybe if I go back here to the zero coupon bond, that was my zero coupon bond, you see that the zero coupon bond here was only defined on the interval from 0 to T2. And if you reach the interval T2, so you observe, I receive one unit, you observe this in T2, then this is equal to 1. Yeah? Then you receive this unit. Maybe you can extend the product after this point and say that this is then 0. Yeah? So this is some way of extending it, but that would be a little bit strange because then it is losing the value. Yeah, you could also put it in some account. Yeah. Okay, so we don't care about this. It's just defined from 0 to T2. And because of that, my ratio is defined from 0 to T1. Yeah, because then this product here ceases to exist. So this is a stochastic process defined on this interval. Okay, what is this object? So why am I defining this? Let's have a look. So I start with looking at the zero bond that matures in T1. Okay, what's that? So if I invest in time T1, that amount, so this here is, this is time little t. So if I invest in time little t, the amount PT1, semicolon t, then I receive back in T1. So hopefully I receive back a little bit more. I receive back one unit of currency, 1 euro. Okay, I just drop the euro. Okay, so I draw the arrow down if the value is negative, yeah? And I draw the arrow up if the value is positive, yeah? So just like a vector, and this is the y component of a vector. So I can buy this financial product. Well, I told you, you can also buy fractions of this financial product. So let's buy a fraction of this financial product. So I multiply this now with some fraction. Okay, so what is the fraction I would like to have? To motivate this, let's take a look at another financial product, the P2 bond. So let's look first at the PT2 bond. So the PT2 bond pays me back one unit of currency in T2. And for that, I have to invest in little t, PT2 observed in little t. And maybe this amount here, P PT2, observed in little t, is a bit smaller because I have to wait longer for receiving back my money. So that makes somewhat the assumption that interest rates are positive. Yeah, so waiting longer, you receive more. So now what I wanted to do here is let's buy just a fraction of this. A fraction, namely, that is I divide by, so I multiply this here, I divide by PT1 and I multiply with PT2. Okay, so this is the ratio of two euro values. So this is a fraction, an amount. Yeah. So I would like to have this amount. So if I do this, what do I have here? I have here that this becomes PT2. Okay, and what I receive back is, well, I receive back is a little bit more than one. Wait, PT2 is smaller. No, one divided by, oh, sorry. What I receive back is a bit smaller than one here. It is PT2 divided by PT1. So PT2 is smaller than PT1. Yeah, so that is smaller than one. Okay, and now I multiply this with a minus. So instead of investing, I'm borrowing. So if I borrow, yeah, I get this amount of money. I borrow this amount of money, and I have to put back this amount of money at this time. And now I go to the bank and actually buy this financial product that is borrow money and this financial product that is invest money. And I take the portfolio of the two. And what do I get in sum? Okay, in sum, whoops. So in sum, we get here we borrow this amount, and that I can use to buy this financial product here. So I need to buy this financial product, but I was able to borrow it. Okay, so that is canceling. But then I have to pay back the amount that I borrowed in T1. So this means in T1, I have to pay back this amount here. So this means I have to pay back here this amount in T1. So what is the amount I have to pay back? It is PT2T divided by PT1T multiplied with one unit of currency. Okay. And I receive back here, okay, so maybe I need a bit of this space here. So I receive back then the amount of 1 euro. So you see from this construction, actually I'm trading in zero bonds, but what I have what I finally have is a financial product. Oops, maybe I make this like this. Okay, so what we have is a financial product where I have two cash flows in the future. So in time T1, I pay the cash flow PT2 divided by T1. So this is the object I'm defining here. And in time T2, I receive back the amount 1 unit. So this is like a zero bond, a zero coupon bond, but I do not have to pay it today to receive back this 1 unit. I have to pay it at a future point in time. One important aspect everything is contracted. So the contract is performed in time little t. So I'm doing a contract today that it at a future point in time, I put something in this account and I receive back one unit. So everything is observed today. Yeah, it's not that in the future I'm doing something under conditions that are known then in the future. Everything is f little t measurable. Yeah? So everything here on this slide is f little t measurable. Yeah, the random variables are known in time, little t. So this ratio of the two zero-coupon bonds, the forward bond, is the amount I have to invest in time t1 to receive one unit in time t2. So this is a little bit now how I can extract the interest rate for a certain period in the future, given that I know all the zero-coupon bonds, yeah, for the different maturities. I know the zero-coupon bonds for different maturities, and now I'm able to extract interest rate for any period in the future. So here is this picture again, yeah, so a little bit nicer than I have drawn it. Yeah. So we have the zero-coupon bond with maturity T1. We just buy a fraction from that. We have the zero-coupon bond in T2, and then we take the difference, which means I take this with a minus sign, which means I take the opposite position. Instead of investing money, I borrow money. And we take then the portfolio of the two to get this product, and this cash flow is canceling. So there's no cash flow in little t because the money I borrow is invested in the other product. So the forward bond value corresponds to the amount that we have to invest in time T1 to receive a guaranteed payment of one unit in T2. And this is also a stochastic process. So this is if we look at the contract in time little t in state omega. So again, you can take the opposite view. Yeah. So you can now just ask yourself, okay, if I invest one unit at time T1, how much do I get back in time T2? And that's just multiply the whole equation with one divided by P T1 T2, observed in little t, okay? So that is here, I observe it in little t. Okay, so one divided by the forward bond is the amount I receive at t2 if I invest one unit in t1. So this allows me now to check what is the amount I receive in excess to one. So what is actually this amount here? Yeah. And I would call this amount the interest I have earned on this future period. So that's my next definition, yeah, that I derive now the interest rates from this object of the forward bond. And I can derive different interest rate for different periods because I have different forward bonds for the periods. So often this forward bond is represented by some rate. Yeah? So, and since this rate is now referencing a period that is forward in time, so at a future point in time, I call it a forward rate. Yeah. So interest rates, which we will define now, are just a different way of describing the structure, yeah, of the forward bonds. And the forward bonds are just the ratios of the zero-coupon bonds. So you see everything is linked together. But now for interest rates, there are many different conventions. So it is just a way of expressing something. And these conventions, for example, do you get interest on interest? Yeah, is there some kind of compounding? How is actually the time measured? Yeah, so T2 minus T1. Yeah, this is an interval of 2 days or 2 dates. Yeah, so what is this? Yeah, how is this measured? Is it measured in seconds, in days, in years? And what is actually 1 year? Yeah, so all these interest rates depend on a lot of conventions. So for that, as a mathematician, I view the interest rate as a derived quantity, and still my forward bond, or even better, the zero coupon bond, as the original quantity that describes my interest rate curve. So I view here the interest rates as derived quantities. And there are a lot of conventions in these definitions. But later in the modeling, we will model these interest rates, because that's often much simpler to model the interest rate and then calculate the bond prices from the interest rates. So let's define some of these and also check the relations of the interest rates. Okay, so I already motivated that 1 divided by the forward bond is the amount that you receive in time T2. So I receive here 1 divided by the forward bond. If I invest 1 unit in time T1, okay, but everything is contracted, so everything is observed in little t. So on this slide, and maybe also on some other slides, I do not mention the little t. So actually all the objects you see here, the pt1 and the pt2 and the pt1 comma t2 and the l, all these objects are now stochastic processes which you can observe at different times before T1. So I already motivated that we can now consider the value that we receive in excess to our original investment. So I receive my original investment, the 1, plus something in addition. So that something in addition is that. And now I would like to measure this something which I receive in addition by a rate. So measuring it by a rate means that I measure it in a per time, on a per time basis. So a rate is something per time. So I express the stuff that I receive in addition in the stuff that I receive divided by the time that I had to wait for this. This is just a definition. Okay, so you see here, this is just a definition. So I'm defining the L in that sense. So I'm defining here the L in this sense. So what is L? So it is PT1 divided by PT2 minus 1. So subtract the 1. So 1 is PT2 divided by PT2 divided by the time fraction. So it's 1 divided by T2 minus T1, the difference of T1 minus PT2. Of PT1 minus PT2 divided by PT2. Okay, so that is the definition of the forward rate. Actually, this is also sometimes called the simple forward rate. So maybe this as a small remark, what is called simple rate? is actually L from little t to capital T observed in T. Yeah? So this is way, this is actually our F, yeah, from the previous slide, the interest rate I observe from now till some time. So that was our F on the introduction, yeah, which is called the simple trade. And simple here because there's no compounding, there's no interest on interest. Yeah, it's just a single linear function, a linear quantity. So linear in the sense multiplied with time. And the word forward rate, the word forward here applies to the period that we are not observing from today to some point in the future, so that we have some forward period, some period from T1 to T2. So we observe some interest rate forward in time. So everything is observed today, but we can apply it to a future period. And then often this object is called the LIBOR. Actually, this name will maybe go out of fashion, yeah, because this London Interbank Offer Rate will be made obsolete by some other quotation convention. But this is often called the LIBOR because this interbank offer rate was quoted according to this convention. So that is now only if you spot this name in some literature, yeah, why the people are calling this the LIBOR rate. It's just because this is the LIBOR convention. So I call it now the forward rate for this period. Okay, so that's now one possible interest rate which we can define. So another way is just to define it using the exponential function. Yeah? So again, I start from 1 divided by the forward bond. So let's draw our picture here again. So I have 1 unit here, and I receive back here 1 divided by the forward bond. Okay, and I ask myself, what is the excess here? Yeah, and now I express this with an exponential function. So e to the 0 is 1. So e to the r times t is the rate which we define. Yeah, so that's just the definition. So if you like to define it, take the logarithm. Okay. Take the logarithm and divide by t2 minus t1. Okay, and then the logarithm of 1 divided by p, t1, t2, the forward bond, is the same as minus the logarithm of p, t1, t2. So I just define now this rate r here as minus the logarithm of the forward bond divided, so per time. Okay, so this gives me a nice multiplicative structure. Yeah? So if I know r from t1 to t2, yeah, so then I have a forward bond from this period. Yeah? So and e to the r t1 t2 multiplied with t2 minus t1 multiplied with e to the r t2 t2 t3 multiplied with the interval, then is this just the sum of the guys in the exponent. Yeah? So this is maybe just nice if I want to have this multiplication, multiplicative structure. Yeah? And you see that if you would like to multiply, yeah, so you see these guys here actually form a telescope product. Yeah, so the forward bond from T1 to T2 to T3 is actually given by multiplying T1 to T2 and T2 to T3. Okay, so that's just an alternative definition. I could define the interest rate in terms of an exponential function. So here in terms of the logarithm of the forward bond price. So then the forward bond price is the ratio of the two bonds. It's actually the difference of the logarithm of the zero coupon bond with maturity T2 and the zero coupon bond, the logarithm of the zero coupon bond with maturity T1 divided by T2 minus T1. So this is called continuously compounded forward rate because it is like a continuously compounding. Yeah, so maybe later I have a nice calculation here. At this point, maybe it's just a definition. Another important interest rate is the instantaneous forward rate. So what's that? So the instantaneous forward rate is if you take our definition for the forward rate. So we take our L and we make the interval infinitesimal small. Yeah? So our forward rate was actually given by some time discretization, or we could actually look at interest rate for discrete times. But now what happens if we take the limit that this period shrinks to an infinitesimal interval? Then I get the interest rate for an infinitesimal interval, so actually for a future point in time, observed today. So I get the interest rate for the interval from capital T to capital T plus dt, but everything is still observed in little t. Okay. So, that's a bit a strange object, but assume that this limit exists. So what is it? How does it relate? So let's plug in the definition of L. So the definition of L was the bond at the beginning of the interval. Let's take green here, the beginning of the interval, minus the bond at the end of the interval. Divided by the bond at the end of the interval, divided by the fraction of time. So divided by the period length. Okay, so that was the definition of L. Okay, let me check. Yeah, you see the bond at the beginning of the interval minus the bond at the end of the interval divided by the bond at the end of the interval divided by the fraction of time. Okay, so if this behaves here nicely, so this means that this guy here is continuous, the limit for T2 to capital T. So if the end of the interval shrinks to the or moves to the beginning of the interval, then this here will converge to P of capital T observed in little t. Yeah? So that's just the bond at the beginning of the interval. And what is that here? Okay, that is a finite difference of the derivative, yeah. So that is actually a finite difference of the bond. Well, not precise. Okay, we have to actually flip the two here, yeah, and give us a minus in front. So if we do this, then this guy here will become the derivative. Sorry, this guy here will become the derivative of the bond with respect to the maturity. So now you have the derivative of the bond with respect to maturity divided by the bond. Okay, that's actually the derivative of the logarithm. So this f, yes, the instantaneous forward rate, is the derivative of the logarithm of the bond price curve, actually minus, yeah, so with respect to maturity. So let's have a small remark here. If the bond price curve is, so the bond at maturity capital T is e to the minus t, say rt minus little t, Yeah. So that would correspond to here taking taking T1 to be capital T, yeah, and taking T2 to be little t. So P little t is 1. So this means on the left-hand side, I just have P capital T. And on the right-hand side, I have e to the little t minus capital T, so which is the same as minus capital T minus little t. So assuming here a constant R, I would have this. So this here is a multiply. Yeah. So then this FTT is just this R. Okay. So that would relate to this R. Okay. So, and the last rate I would like to define in this section here is the short rate. So what is now the short rate? So for the short rate, I let now the capital T move to little t. So the short rate is also just a rate for an infinitesimal period, but it is the rate for the infinitesimal period starting just now. Okay. So here the little t is the time at which we observe the stochastic process. Yeah. So this is an interest rate which is starting just now, and it is valid for an infinitesimal small period. Yeah. So it is the period from now to capital T, observed now, and letting the period length shrink to zero, so letting capital T go to little t. So if you plug in the definition of R, so R was the one that was defined using the exponential function, then this is the limit, yeah, capital T goes to little t. So actually this is differentiate, yeah, because this here is like a finite difference. Yeah. So this is like differentiate the logarithm of the bond price curve. So differentiate the logarithm of the bond price curve. So it was minus with respect to capital T and plug in little t. Okay. Differentiating the logarithm is differentiate the bond price curve divided by the bond itself, plugging in little t for capital T, so plugging in little t for capital T, I can use that contracting today that I get one unit paid today is just one. Yeah. I can drop this guy. So this is just differentiate the bond price curve. So the short rate is just the derivative of the bond price curve observed today. Yeah. So the slope that I observed today, actually minus, yeah, because the bond price curve is decaying with respect to the maturity. Okay, so we have seen many different interest rates now. Yeah, discretized interest rate, the forward rates, actually in two different versions. Yeah, just linear, 1 plus L times time, or continuously compounded, so exponential R times time. And then we have seen an infinitesimal rate. Of course, I can then later reconstruct the curve by taking the integral. And now I have seen the short rate, which is just an interest rate at a single point in time. And it looks a little bit as if this last step was maybe too much. So maybe we have lost information because how can it be that just a single point contains all the information for the future interest rates? That's a bit strange. Yeah. So all the other guys are okay. Yeah. They are just different intervals or an infinitesimal interval, which you maybe, if you integrate it, you get the full integral interval. But why is that here? Yeah. So why is that enough to describe the whole curve? So I have an answer to this next, yeah, but first let me just remark, I defined here the short rate as the limit of R, which was the continuously compounded forward rate, so the one with the exponential. You can also define the limit using the L, and it gives you the same value. Yeah. Okay, that is just because exponential RT for small intervals T is exactly the same as 1 plus RT with a small interval T. Yeah. So not exactly the same, but it's the first order term. And if the interval becomes infinitesimal, the two agree. So the short rate can be defined with the R and the L, and actually the infinitesimal forward rate also. So now you have seen different rates, and these rates are now the fundamental objects in interest rate modeling. So whether you start from forward rates and say that a forward rate is a stochastic process, or you start from the instantaneous forward rate, so either the simple rate or the instantaneous forward rate or the short rate, they define different models. So each of these rates here will define different models. A forward rate model, if you model L as a stochastic process, the HGM framework, if you model F as a family of stochastic processes, yeah, F depends on two arguments, little t and capital T. So for every capital T, you have a stochastic process in little t. The same for L. Yeah? L is some discretized intervals, so you have also a family of stochastic processes. And the short rate models, which just model a single scalar object, the short rate. And I already mentioned that the short rate model worked very popular because that was so simple. You have a single scalar object that models a single interest rate, and you can build the curve from it, as we will see later. Okay, so these interest rates model, they look quite different, but actually they are just all the same. So for example, the LIBOR market model is a short rate model, and it's also an HGM model. So maybe some people would now say, okay, the LIBOR market model is a short rate model. How can that be? Yeah, you can rewrite the model in terms of the short rate. The only thing is that in the model, the short rate is likely not a Markovian process. Yeah, so that will be a detail which I can explain later. But actually, all these things, forward rates, instantaneous forward rates, short rate, are just different ways of expressing the same object. And in some coordinates, some things are more simple, and in other coordinates, some things are more difficult. But you can actually show that they are links between all these models. So sometimes it's just if it is simpler to write something in a certain coordinate because it looks much nicer in a certain coordinate than in another coordinate. All these things are just coordinates describing the same object, the interest rate curve, which popped out from the zero Cooper bond, yeah, our single object. So now I will start defining interest rate products in the next session, but I will start with one, say, you could say interest rate product that actually defines another rate. And there will be another example, the swap rate, which we will do in the next session. But let's look now at the accrual account and then the backward looking rate. So assume we take now the view that we have a time discretization, which defines a tenor structure. So I have some time discretization here that defines periods from, say, T0 to T1, and from T1 to T2, and so on. And for all these periods, I can observe interest rates, the interest rate from here to here, the interest rate from here to here, from there to there. Yeah. Then assume now that all these guys here, they can move, they are stochastic processes. So maybe, I don't know, so maybe T0 is little t. So I assume that T0 is little t. So that means that one is maybe already fixed, but this one can still move. Yeah, they can still move up and down. Yeah, the whole interest rate curve is moving while the little t, the time, moves forward. Yeah? So then I could do the following. I can take one unit of currency, say here. So I start with a one, and I invest it in a zero coupon bond that pays at the end of the period. Okay, at the end of the period. So what do I get at the end of the period? I get 1 divided by PT1 observed in T0. Yeah, I started in T0. I invested this. Okay, and you know that this was just 1 plus L. So actually, that was our definition of the interest rate from T0, T2, T1 observed in T0 multiplied with the time interval. Okay, so I started with one currency unit, €1 or $1. You invest this, and that is the amount that you receive at the end of the period. You receive your one back and something in addition, so plus L times the time. So now you invest this again. But now I invest this in a bond that pays at the end of the next period, but in a bond that I'm trading in T1. So now suddenly the time here changes, T1, okay? And what do I get back? I get back my original amount multiplied with 1 plus L T1 to T2 observed in T1 multiplied with T2 minus T1. So actually, if this here was the amount that I had at the end, what I have at the end of the interval T0, T2, T1, what I have at the end of the interval from T0 to T2 is the product of the two, because I can invest the whole amount that I received back from the first interval into units of the zero coupon bond T1 to T2. Okay, so I receive the complete initial value multiplied with the new product. So that means that when I do this repeatedly, what I receive in the end is the product of all these 1 plus L starting point, end point, observed at the starting point, multiplied with the period length, end point minus starting point. So the big difference is here that we observe the interest rates always at the beginning of the period. We observe the interest rate always at the beginning of the period. So you see the object that is written there is not f little t measurable. It's not something that we contract in little t. It's a contract that is always renewing at the rate that is available at this point in time. So it is an accrual account. It's accruing, and it's a stochastic process. And this object is fti minus one measurable, yeah, because the so it's at least fti minus one measurable. Yeah, so it's accruing at this interest rate. So equivalently, we could write this in terms of the instantaneous forward rate. Yeah? So the interest rate, instantaneous forward rate, was differentiate L. So if I would like to have L back, it's integrate. Yeah. So it was the, so actually you can just have a look. Yeah, this here is the same as 1 plus L, yeah, from TJ to TJ plus one, observed in TJ. Yeah, so this observed in TJ is actually the first argument here. So I just integrate, yeah, multiplied with tj plus 1 minus tj. So you see, if you write this in this form, the product of the exponential is the exponential of the sum. It becomes quite nice, you know, because what's this here? A sum of integrals from tj to tj plus 1. Okay, this is like an Euler discretization. So this is like an integration rule. This is an Euler discretization. Well, of what you get if you integrate f. Okay, this here is always the beginning of the interval. So Euler scheme is always taking the value of the integrand at the beginning of the interval and then using this constant value. So this is like ftt dt from, now it's from t0 to the end is tj plus 1 with I minus 1 ti. Okay, so that is actually a discretization of the integral t0 to t1 r of t dt. Okay, so you see, actually, this is here ti. So actually you see that this guy here is a little bit like the numerator in the Black-Scholes model, e to the rt, with a constant r, but now r does depend on time. This is e to the integral from t0 to ti rt dt. So you see that this object, which I'm constructing here, so this product here, is the discrete analog to the continuously accruing account that accrues continuously at the short rate. It's the discretized version. So this accrual account is very useful, yeah, and it's often chosen as a numerator. And yeah, it's maybe helpful to understand that it's the analog to the Black-Scholes case. So if you consider in continuum of infinitesimal periods, yeah, then this corresponds to actually this guy here, yeah, so which you maybe remember looks very much like the numerator in the Black-Scholes model if R is not deterministic. So now to conclude this session, there is a small issue here. This object here is only defined for discrete times. Yeah, it's only defined at the end of the period. At the end of each period. So I would like to make it continuous. But I already told you what I do. I invest always in the bond that matures at the end of the period. So I can define now a financial product that lives over all times and at each time discretization point has this value. And this here is my rolling bond. So this is the investment strategy, which is beneath this, yeah, so the rolling bond. So it is actually investing always in the bond that matures at the next period. So this here is the bond that matures at the end of the next period. The bond that matures at the end of the next period. And that here is just the money which we have accrued. So this is the amount accrued. Okay, and you see that this sum here goes to m of t, yeah, because I invest in the beginning 1 unit. And then I receive 1 divided by, so the bond I have invested is 1, then 1 divided by the bond price, which is 1 plus L. Okay, so maybe you can have a look at this. Yeah, this is just the continuous analog to the previous definition, this R of T. And now using this R of T, I can define another rate, namely the performance of this accrual account. So if I accrue over a certain period of time, I started with 1 unit in the beginning. How much do I have in the end in excess to this 1 unit I have invested in the beginning? So I take the ratio of what I have invested in the beginning, so the value RS where I have started, and the value RT where I have ended, RT divided by RS minus 1 is the excess amount I receive in RT if I have started with RS. And then I divide this by time to get the performance of this account. So this account will in the end reach 10% higher than in the beginning. So now you see that this rate here is not like the others observed at the beginning of the interval in S. This rate is actually observed at capital T. So this is a so-called backward-looking rate, and we will discuss this maybe in the next session again, but a nice feature is that the expectation of receiving this backward-looking rate is the same as the expectation of receiving a forward rate. So actually, with respect to expectations, so that is a small lemma, which we will prove then. With respect to expectations, there's no difference in actually receiving this accrued performance or receiving the forward rate, which we observed in the beginning. Okay, so that was my first session on interest rates with a lot of definitions. And in the next session, we will then start working on interest rate products, so products that use these rates. So that's it for today.